Hi, welcome to this week's Astrology Oracle. I'm your astrologer, April Shaley, and we have a lot going on the astrological front this week. We've got the new moon on Friday, right? Or on Saturday, excuse me, at 9:12 a.m. Eastern Time. You can do your calculations. Remember that here we didn't, in Eastern Time, Daylight Savings Time has ended. In Europe, where I live, it has not yet. So, or in Ireland, where I live, it hasn't. So make your calculations accordingly. We have Mercury retrograde next week. Yeah, it's true. And we have Mars ingressing into Capricorn on Saturday. It's going to bring some grounding and focus and some work ethic into the equation. And we have a dark moon today, as I'm recording, leading into that new moon that's happening on Saturday morning. Another feature to this that's a really big deal is the equinox. This is the rebirth of the sun into the first sign of the zodiac, coming out of the second or the last sign of the zodiac into its rebirth, into Aries, the adolescent of the signs, you know. So what do we do now? Okay, that's stuff. So now what do we do? Well, we're still in this Piscean place. What does that mean? Pisces is the last stop on the choo-choo train of the zodiac. It's where all the other signs meet and blend back together, and it's like where all of the experiences that we have in life, the collective unconscious, and it's where all the experiences that everyone has had throughout time go back together into the great cauldron, into the great ocean, the great mother, and mix it up back again like a snow globe. And then at the spring equinox, everything's thrown back out there, and new life, new form of life appears, right? New cycle. And so here in Ireland, where I live, the daffodils have started to bloom. The crocuses have started to come out. It's really lovely. Yesterday I was at a cemetery that's close by, and I love the vision of these beautiful flowers coming out of the grave. And in the background, there's these graves, and I just think of Persephone and her return at the equinox. And she went down into the underworld at the fall equinox. For you in the southern hemisphere, this will be reversed, of course. And in the spring equinox, she comes out, right? Or the seasons will be reversed for you guys. Here in the northern hemisphere, it's the spring equinox on Tuesday. Again, the sun ingresses into the sign that is ruled by Mars, Aries. And so a rebirth happens, an emergence from the soil, from the chthonic realm where Persephone is queen of the underworld. She's done her tour. She's claimed her souls. She is queen of shades. She is queen of shadows. She's gone through the winter and gone through the depths of her psyche, or she's watched a lot of Netflix and you know, serial and binged on, you know, Netflix series and ate a lot of carbs. That's another option, right? But, or she's just really sick of blizzards by now. You know, I know back where I was living in Salem, you guys have gotten hit a lot, right? By snow. Anyway, Snow Queen gives it up. She's starting to lose her power. And the Maiden starts to emerge. And so this rebirth can happen for all of us now. Pisces is a sign of letting go. A lot of us have perhaps been having that experience. I know that I can say for myself that I am finding certain doors are closing in my life. And for me, it's a relief. I'm glad. I've known that this was coming for a while and these cycles are ending. I've outgrown them. it's over. And there is this new cycle opening up. Things have dissolved. And, you know, as we go through a cycle of experience, we create connections, right? We create these this tapestry of interwoven, energetic threads, if you will, and connections to other people and attachments. And we build that, and we put lots of stuff in the box that we're trying to build this construction. And then things happen where it's time for that to end. And then there's this unraveling that happens and a dissolving that happens. That thread starts to get weak and starts to fall apart. And that's to make space for the new, again, the emergence of the new. And that unraveling of the tapestry of connection and attachment and investment and all of that can be anxiety-inducing, because we humans do have this tendency to want to stay attached to what we know. And there can be some grief, too, as well as relief, maybe. Maybe there's both, where some of these friendships are ending, some of these attachments are ending. There was a lot of value in this, and what's going to be next? Well, that's what is going, we're going to find out what's going to be next. That will be revealed. And we get to also create what's going to be next through our intention setting, through our dream, through our visioning, through the Pisces wants us, or Pisces wants us. We Pisces energy is conducive to retreat, sanctuary, withdrawal from too many, non-essential concerns, meditation, connection, heart opening. And when we do that, and we do that work, what happens? We're who we truly are. Our authentic self, our authentic soul is revealed, is no longer hidden or obscured or distorted in any way. And then we know exactly what we're supposed to do. We know exactly what road we're supposed to go down, because it feels like going home to ourselves. That's the part we forget. We're always looking for it outside of ourselves. And Pisces energy reminds us that it is not ever. What we're looking for is never outside of ourselves. It's always within. That's where it's at. So the equinox then becomes this doorway that the visioning and letting go and all of the, that process, that inner process, then gets to be externalized. And we're like the holy fool, number zero in the tarot, with our little bag and our little dog, and we can just like be completely innocent and released from the past. You probably hear my dogs barking. And released from the past so that we can move forward. And the best way to release the past and to move forward is to be present, in present time, in the now, connected to the body. That's one of the doorways, that connecting our consciousness with our bodies is a doorway into presence. And you can use your body and your focusing your body, focusing your consciousness in on your the sensations in your body, the energetic sensations, doing like a scan of that, going through the chakras, if you're familiar with the chakras, finding, just connecting with yourself. And that's how you get present. Our truth is where our presence is. So that's one of the things that we are we can meditate on right now. So Mars goes into Capricorn on Saturday with the new moon going on at the same time. That's a wonderful support for focusing in these these very transpersonal and collective unconscious or dreams, all of this, you know, archetypes, it can be overwhelming. And that's what Pisces energy can feel like, this great overwhelming flood. Again, this can be a relief, wash it away, rebaptize my life, or it can be like a, you know, a threat. Oh my gosh, tidal wave, right? But there is dry land ahead, and Mars in Capricorn shows us how to take these energies and focus them someplace that is useful. And that brings us closer to our goals and how to, it's like takes that energy, that vibrational energy of Pisces, and enables us to manifest something productive, tangible, worldly, out of this very unworldly energy. So that, I think, is a positive support. Not only that, but Mars is our boundary guy. He's the guy, we all have a Mars somewhere in our chart, but Mars is the guy who says, this is my boundary. If you cross this, I'm gonna respond to that in a way that keeps my boundary intact. Mars is our action guy. You know, he's the guy that Mars in our chart is the reason why we wake up in the morning and do anything, because we have this will to live. Like, Mars is that. In Capricorn, Capricorn's a sign of boundaries. Pisces has no boundaries whatsoever. So Capricorn moving, Mars moving into Capricorn is very useful for, again, you know, this oneness journey that we can be on when everything, you know, when the sun is in Pisces, needs eventually, if we're going to actually live here on Earth, to get refocused and put to use. You know, put to some sort of worldly endeavor, because we're here to live physically. We're not here to just try to get out of that. We came into physical bodies to have them and to experience time and space and feelings, you know, physical feeling and senses and all of that. So anyway, we have the equinox Tuesday, which we talked about already, and then Mercury retro. Gotta talk about that. Yuppers, Mercury goes retrograde on Thursday, right? Just making sure. I'm gonna look at my little notes here. Thursday, yep. Mercury retrograde happens in the sign of Aries. So he's gonna make it back over to Pisces eventually. And so Mercury retrograde is all the revisioning, re-examining, re-evaluating, remembering, reiterating, anything recycling, redoing. And so it's a very valuable time, because the things that we didn't do well the first time, we get another chance at, perhaps. Things that we didn't quite, where we didn't dot our I's and cross our T's, maybe we signed something that wasn't good for us, or we did something that wasn't in our best interest, we get a chance to, like, you know, go back and refocus our energies differently. And this is also a time where things that we thought we had put to rest are going to come out again, to really get communicated properly and get things managed. So Mercury retrograde is a time that some people find really frustrating, because it's an introverted time. It's not a time where we can just get out there and do, you know, go forward in ways we might like to, especially in Aries. It goes backwards in Aries. It gets really frustrated in that, because Aries is all about go forward, do it, you know, and do it fast, right? So Mercury in the sign becomes introverted, goes inward. So it's like you think, okay, your introspection's over, awesome, equinox happened, but there's more of it. And the other thing is that we have a superstition with Mercury going retrograde that we can't sign contracts, we shouldn't buy anything, we shouldn't make any big purchases, we shouldn't do so many things, and everything's gonna suck and break down. We can blame Mercury retro for everything. Those things aren't true. Mercury's retrograde a lot of the time of the year. So if you refrain from doing anything and moving forward in any way, it's not really helpful to do that because you're just gonna stall your life a lot. Mercury's retrograde 3 weeks each time it's retro, and it does that 3 times a year. So like, it's not gonna be really helpful to postpone everything. But it is a time where we have to be very careful and pay attention to detail. Mercury in Aries doesn't like to pay attention to detail. I know that because I have Mercury in Aries. So I know that for a fact. We like the big picture. We like mythic proportions, and we like everything to be, you know, exciting and new. Mercury retrograde in Aries isn't about, well, Mercury retrograde is about going over things again that have already transpired. But you can sign contracts, you can do those kinds of things. It's just, you have to be extra careful, and it's a reminder, you know, it's like if you haven't been taking care of your car, you haven't been taking care of your computer, you were supposed to do something with it, get it repaired. You noticed that there were things going on with it, you ignored it. Mercury goes retro. Guess what happens? We pay. So that's why it has that reputation. The ways that we're not maintaining the things that go forward, that involve transportation, that involve communication, those things tend to come undone. We have Mercury retro because the universe is actually trying to help us out to get our acts together and get us to do things well, right? So we've got a card to pick, don't we? Because we do that every week. We like doing that. So we have another bit of information. And this, I like picking tarot cards because astrology, somebody asked me why I don't do tarot readings. And I do. I do tarot readings. I just do those privately and in other contexts than professional. But astrology is very clear in what is going on. I don't know how else to say that. It's a science, it's a map. It's like following a roadmap. Tarot, one of the things I like about tarot, I'm pulling this card for you, is that it's very much about right now. What thoughts are we having right now? This is collective. So what's our collective creation? What's our collective like vibration? We're gonna find out right now. All of you who are watching, this is for all of us. We all put this together and we all picked the following card, which is the Knight of Coins. Okay, so the Knight of Coins is Earth, and he is a guy who, this is Mars in Capricorn to me. Again, not necessarily the corresponding card in the tarot. I don't always care about that for our purposes. He's a very practical guy, and he wants to take action in a very practical way. So I think that this is telling us to, or giving us the advice that we can take or leave, free will universe, that to harness those Mars and Capricorn energies to ground and our dreams into a focus that will have some tangible, useful results. Okay, so he's got a little dog with him, and he's got a coin in the air. I like that this is, you know, the coin just floating in the air there. He's on a pretty sturdy horse. He's not racing around looking for fun. He's about like, let's make this actually happen in concrete reality. He's got a cautiousness to him. And so does Mars in Capricorn, also has a cautiousness to it. And a focus on making something useful and experiential and concrete. Something that's going to actually fortify our lives in a way that benefits us and is in our higher good. All right, so with that, I'm going to say that this report is a complete one. Thank you for tuning in. Please join me on my Patreon site, April's Astrology. You can look that up, patreon.com, and become a patron. And visit my site at aprilsarcana.com or aprilsastrology.com. And I'll see you there. Take care. Many blessings. Bye now.